You know, as Bass After Dark's resident old guy, I've seen a lot of changes in the world of bass fishing and in the world at large. Some of them have been amazing, life-changing, and things that I enjoy every day. Others have been disappointing, disillusioning, and occasionally disgusting. A lot of them, on both sides, have been delivered by the internet. Before the internet, our encounters with people were mostly in person or on the phone. Today, it's mostly through email, text, chat, or something far less personal than was available before the digital age. That lack of personal contact has done a lot to alter the tenor of our exchange. Before, we seemed to spend more time examining our position than typing it in all caps, calling someone else an idiot or a Nazi, or even comparing them to Hitler. Seriously, Hitler. The guy who picked a fight with the rest of the world and murdered 6 million Jews. These days, it seems, we pick a side, then we defend that side. If the other side pauses long enough, we take a shot at them. Too often, that shot is too hard or too bold for the issue or the stakes. But by then, it's too late. We're entrenched. So we fight on, even though a cooler head might realize he's wrong, or at least not as right as he thought. But all that's left is to call the other guy an idiot, a liar, a cheat, or even Hitler. I read every word posted in the comments section under our YouTube posts. Generally, they're positive or funny or even insightful. I try to respond to every one of them that calls for a response, even if it's just a thank you for watching or listening. Sometimes, though, we get on a topic that's a real hot button in our sport, like last week's topic or tonight's topic, which is really the same topic. Forward-facing live sonar, and the youth movement. The comments on the stuff tend to be more spirited, more combative, more polarizing. I get it. People have strong feelings about forward-facing sonar and the technology and the youth movement. It's caused a major shift in the way some anglers fish, in the way some tournaments are won, and in the way anglers spend money for their fishing. It threatens traditional methods, budgets, and even careers, but it shouldn't threaten our ability to think. One of the reasons we do Bass After Dark is to present different facets of our sport and show them from different perspectives. That's why we have three guests, but only one real question. It's why we encourage an open conversation among the guests. It's what we think makes Bass After Dark different and hopefully worthwhile. Very few commenters don't get that. Most can handle it. Most enjoy it. Most want to see the perspectives. But some can't handle it. They can't handle the differing views. And instead, they choose to call other people names or question their integrity, when really only their ideas or preferences or methods are really under discussion. I want to see your comments. I want your opinions and thoughts on the show. Every show. But we should all listen before deciding and think before insulting. It makes our opinions a lot better, a lot stronger, and it guarantees they'll be taken a lot more seriously. Welcome to Bass After Dark. I'm Ken Duke, coming to you live from the Sheraton Birmingham, site of the 2024 Red Crest, where my internet connection is shakier than the tip of a swim jig rod. We're here tonight to earn your support, your subscription, your like, and your share by showing you that inch for inch and pound for pound, we are the most illuminating show in bass fishing. Now it's time to bring on my co-host. Please welcome the man who put the B in bass, BTC.
What's up, Ken? It was very, Second round of applause.
You deserve two rounds of applause.
Well, thank you. It was very kind of you, that introduction. Undeserved, but very kind, and it disarmed me. I'm not going to say what I was going to say, which was could be meant as a joke, but very harsh.
Well, it sounds like most of your jokes.
Yes.
Well, By the way, I just got a text from one of our guests who's probably not going to be able to join us because he doesn't seem to be able to get his internet connection working. But I understand that two of our guests are now with us. So we're looking forward to welcoming them in just a moment.
But two out of three ain't bad, right, Ken?
That's what Meatloaf taught me in the 70s.
Yes, indeed.
I did not think that Meatloaf would be worked into this conversation, but there he is.
Yes. Meatloaf.
Yeah, now this has been a challenging show to put together.
Indeed.
I want to tell you, and of course, tonight's question is, are we witnessing a youth movement or a tech revolution in bass tournament fishing? And in talking to guys about this subject, we learned very early that not everyone was comfortable talking about it. Not everybody wanted to go on the record and discuss it. We talked to a number of manufacturers just to say, hey, what do you think about us tackling this subject? And we weren't looking to them for guests. We got the guests we wanted to get, but we were talking to them about their attitude toward it. And what we found out is that it can be touchy. It can be sketchy. And we're excited that we have the guys we have tonight, because they're gonna shed some real light on it.
That's right, Ken. And the South is still very much challenged when it comes to Wi-Fi signal.
So it seems, you know, here I am at the Sheraton in Birmingham, where one of our guests is 11 floors above me right now. That's right. And hopefully he's...
And the other one's still waiting for a microwave to be brought down the road so he can have that technology.
There you go. But hey, we're going to get to that in a moment. We got other things planned for tonight as well. BTC, please tell them about the kind of the full feel of Bass After Dark.
That's right. So obviously we have tonight's question of the night. Afterwards, we have the top 10, the top 10 signs you're not going to win a tournament. And this was a good one. Again, back-to-back weeks that I wasn't the most disappointed with the voting. That it was Ken Duke that was throwing a tantrum this time. And our other partner, Nathan, both of them. But it was good, because usually it's me very disappointed with how the voting goes. So I'll take that as a win, even though they got the majority of the jokes in there. So we have that. We also have bad comments with our intern, the Lizard King, Jacob Morrison. So guys, Jacob's on notice, the funniest jokes. If he thinks it's inappropriate, I said, Jacob, write it down. That's probably what we want.
There you go. So folks, yeah, if you have a comment, if you have a question for me or Brian or Nathan, or even for Jacob, put it in that, what do they call it? The live chat part on YouTube, and we'll get it in there.
And of scathing jokes.
Scathing jokes. And if you want to take a shot at us, not at our guests are going to be, taken off the show by that point. So keep it to us. We also have dark thoughts. Tell them about dark thoughts.
Dark thoughts. It's inexplicable. That's where usually by the end of the show, couple of these deep, losing my inhibitions, and I just kind of weigh in on whatever's on my mind. So it's like the antithesis to Ken's very well thought out monologue.
Sometimes thought out. All right, let's get to it, man. Tonight's question: are we witnessing a youth movement, or is this a technological revolution?
That's right. And our guest, we're introducing our guest, Ken.
We, for the first time, we have two guests. One of our guests is not able to join us this evening because he is having internet issues. So let me introduce our first guest. He is the 2011 Forest Wood Cup champion, the 2015 FLW Angler of the Year, a bass winner, a classic qualifier, a superstar of the sport. Ladies and gentlemen, Scott Martin.
What's up?
Wow. I like that. Welcome, intro. Scott.
Special.
Well, hey, man, you're special and got to get a special intro. We appreciate you coming on the show.
That's awesome. Thank you.
And,
appreciate you
and
having
for
me.
Putting up with my wardrobe. See, I don't have the credentials that you and our other guests have, so I have to dress really, really well.
It looks sharp. I like the blue, man. I'm a blue guy, so I like the blue.
There you go. There you go. Our next guest, BTC, you want to introduce him? You want me to?
You can, Ken, if you don't mind. I'm working on fixing my background because I'm jealous of Scott's got that shit back there somewhere. put my own.
Yes, that's right. He's got the Happy Gilmore checks. You know, you got to like that.
Yeah, I need that.
Our next guest is not only an Elite Series champion. He is one of the foremost with a frog, with a swim bait. He's a West Coast guy. Come East. His name is Freddie Boom Boom Roumbanis.
Hey, what's going on, guys? What's up, Scott?
What's up, dude?
Hey, man, it's awesome to be here. Well, Brian, Ken?
If
Ken, I love this suit.
Thank you, man. I appreciate it. Yeah, that's I got to bring class to the show somehow, and this is really my only shot. But if Fred's draperies look the same as mine, it's because he is 11 floors above me at the Birmingham Sheraton right now, where we're getting ready to witness the Red Crest 2024. And Fred, thank you so much for joining us. You may have some of the same shaky internet problems I do, but hopefully we can get through this with no problems. Guys, you guys have a front row seat. Now, last week, you probably didn't have a chance to watch that show, but last week we tackled the same question. Are we experiencing a youth movement or a tech revolution? And that time we had guys who are renowned for their skills with forward facing and who are part of that younger generation. We had Ben Milliken, we had Trey McKinney, and we had Alton Jones Jr. Now, we're not saying you guys are old, but you are more experienced than that crew. I don't even know what that was. Sorry about that, whatever that was. But you are more experienced than that crew, and you guys have earned amazing reputations and won a lot of money and won a lot of tournaments with what let's call more conventional, time-honored, traditional methods. And we want to get your take on it. So, Scott, let me start with you. Let me ask you point blank, just as a starting point, is this a youth movement? Are the young guys that good, or is this mostly a technology shift?
I think it's a balance of both, to be honest with you, because here's the deal, Ken, is that when I was starting out 25 years ago, when I first went on the road and I won my first tournament, I didn't know what I was doing. I knew how to throw a lipless crankbait and drag a worm around and throw a spinnerbait. And that was about the gist of my experience. And it took me years to build into my techniques of drop shotting and crankbaiting and all the different things that I did. And I'm still learning today. But it took a long time. We didn't have YouTube. We had Bassmaster magazine and some magazines that we read, and you would hear about techniques, but we didn't get a chance to, you know, really implement them as much. And so you take these guys now, the 20-year-old guys that are on tour, and they've grown up fishing on the bass fishing teams, high school, college, learning everything at a fast pace. So, you know, they are sonar, technology, all that stuff taken away from them. They know how to fish. They know how to fish. These guys know exactly what to do. They have a full repertoire of techniques
all the time.
100%. And so does technology help them? Absolutely. Are they able to process that technology at a faster rate than a lot of the guys that are still trying to learn this technology? Absolutely. I mean, it's the same way when I watch my kids play video games and I sit down and try to play video games with them. I can't even hardly do the things that they're doing on Fortnite and all this stuff. And they're jumping off buildings and doing all, and their processing is just so much faster. So it's a mixture of both. These young anglers have all the tools to catch fish without it, and they have all the experience and tools to take that technology and just push it to the absolute limit and create things that are just hard to recreate.
Fred, something that Scott just said there clicked on for me and made me think about this whole question in a different way. You know, this forward-facing sonar stuff might be the first technique or method that young anglers are not learning from the previous generation. You know, when you and Scott were learning how to flip and pitch or work a spinnerbait or something like that, well, Scott was getting it from one of the greatest anglers of all time, his dad, and the rest of us were learning from Bassmaster magazine or watching Roland and Bill and Hank.
Yeah, I mean, I was still getting it from his dad. I just was watching it on TV.
Well, you were getting the second hand.
So.
The sad thing is, though, I do have to say this one thing. The sad thing is, just to clarify, put on the record, my dad was gone 24/7. There was no cell phones, no FaceTime. He was on the road fishing tournaments, duck turkey hunting. I didn't fish with my dad, but like, who taught me to fish a spinnerbait was me. you know, okay. tried and true out on the water. Who taught me how to flip a mat? Me. Love my dad to death. And he gave me advice along the way, but we didn't have time. We didn't fish as much as a lot of people think. I just want to say that just because I think a lot of people think like, you know, my dad was out there like, hey, son, here's what you do. You know, you do this and this is the technique. Like, it was none of that. Like, I learned how to fish certain things from other anglers, you know?
I didn't mean to put that on you, Scott, like that. I apologize. That was not my intention.
Yeah.
But you were learning from things like Bassmaster Magazine. You were learning from watching TV. You were learning from magazines. And this forward-facing sonar stuff might be the first technique.
That's a very good point.
Guys are learning on their own.
Yeah, very good point.
Fred, what do you think about that? Is this the first time we've seen that situation where a guy who's 17, 18, 19 years old, like a Trey McKinney, can pick it up all on his own? He doesn't need you or Scott or anybody else to show him. He's doing it on the water in real time by himself.
100% true, because I got a son who fishes just about every day after school. We've got a little aluminum boat with the live scope. You know, it's rigged out. It's for these watershed lakes where you can't have an outboard. So he'll go take that down to the local lakes, and he just learns the bass behavior through the technology. And he's actually teaching me stuff. And I was with Scott. I mean, we've been with Garmin. I know Scott's been with Garmin longer than I have, but we were the first ones to see the original Panoptix. And I was fortunate enough to be in some of the meetings with Scott when we got to see the live scope when it first came out. And to see how the kids pick it up different than the way that I've, you know, utilized it in tournaments, it's pretty cool, honestly. There's a lot to learn. There's a lot to still be discovered. I think there's a lot of misconception of how easy it is to go out there and compete with these guys that are good at it. There's definitely a different level, like Scott was saying, like the Fortnite situation. I can't really go to Fortnite because my youngest plays it. I don't know what the heck's going on. But I can go back to like when I got Nintendo when I was younger and Super Mario Brothers. It took me like a week of playing straight through to save the princess using all the cheat codes and everything, right? And then my buddies could go get the Nintendo and in like 2 days do it all. You know, so some people are just better at that kind of, you know, learning and perception. I don't feel like I suck at it. Don't get me wrong. I love doing it. I'm you know, I know what it takes to compete against these guys, and I feel like my boat is rigged the best it's ever been rigged for every application, and I'm getting better every day. But these kids, they grew up on iPads. They grew up on cell phones. We didn't have cell phones. It's funny because I had to borrow a truck, and it had windows that you had to roll up, and my kid didn't even know what that was. Like, what in the world is that thing? I mean, it's just, you know, our perception is so different than what the youth have. And to answer your question, there's definitely a youth movement, 110%, and there's definitely a technical advancement going on too that is basically growing the sport.
I want both you guys to hand your kids a rotary phone and ask them to call somebody. Mm-hmm. And then the hilarity ensues.
Went to an antique store and did the same thing. It cracks me up, but that's what we're dealing with. I mean, it's just it's the times we live in.
Freddie, how much does forward facing play a role in your fishing?
I mean, a lot. I use it to identify structure, probably more so than doing it for the visual floating bass. I mean, I love doing that too. Don't get me wrong, but I mean, you definitely need to know what kind of cover. I mean, I actually, honestly, after watching Scott do the bed fishing deal with perspective mode, that's like my new deal. Is like, I want to learn to do what Scott can do. So Scott, I feel, is probably the best at just that right there of anybody, understanding how to use it in perspective mode.
For old guys or for anybody?
For anybody. It doesn't have to be a young guy. Sorry, Scott, but I really do believe you are. I mean, it's fun to watch. I went back and watched the Bassmaster Open of you down at Okeechobee. It was so cool. And that opened up a whole new deal for me. So, of course, what do I got to do? I got to go set it all up on my boat. Now I got perspective. It took me forever to get them. I mean, there's, you know, you still got to get everything set up right, too. So, you know, and then learn it and understand it and identify and then figure out how you can utilize it. it's very impressive to me how young these kids are. Scott's right there too with his kids. I mean, it's like, it's incredible. It's incredible.
You use it when you're throwing a frog?
Nah, not so much. I mean, I would now perspective mode around lily pads and stuff. I can see the bait and everything. Perspective mode, you know, you're taking that, you know, that, what is it, Scott? What is it? 10, 15, 20 degree?
Right. Total? Yeah.
But, anyway, you're flipping it this way. It really works well in that shallow water. I mean, like when you're 10 foot and less, it picks up every single thing you can imagine. So you can see schools of bait, you can see bass swimming. I mean, it definitely is something I'll utilize more for frog fishing.
Yeah.
But a lot of the time, some of the places I've been fishing recently where I live at Lake Darnell, I got to have my trolling motor out of the water because it's just too shallow to even move. But that's just how the fish migrate on the rivers a little bit. But yeah, I mean, it's every day you figure something new out about it. And I kind of store it in the back of my mind. How can I utilize this in a tournament?
Hey Scott, go ahead, BTC.
I was going to say, Scott, is this technology good for the sport? It's coming from Bass Fanatic on YouTube. What do you think?
I think it's fine for the sport. Personally, I mean, I'm 100% loving live scope. I've been an early adopter to it when it first came out, like Fred said. You know, it's like anything else. I mean, you know, like I get the argument. I do understand the concern that people have. You know, when you hear someone that's passionately, you know, kind of saying like we shouldn't have it, I do understand what they're saying. But at the same time, it's like, well, you know, yeah, we're going to probably need to get rid of side scan too, because like when side scan was brand new, I remember them, how awesome that was just doing side scan. Like people going to these lakes at Kentucky Lake and side scanning those bars and finding all the shell beds. And I remember when the maps finally turned from the little crappy bread trails that we had to high definition maps, and all the local people around these lakes said, oh, you know, it's not like it used to be where you had to read a map and triangulate trees and telephone poles to find a spot. Now you can just show up to a lake. I haven't bought a paper map in 15 years. You know, I literally look at my GPS and drive around, and that puts me on more fish than anything. Like, how would I know where to fish at any of these lakes that we go to? Like, exactly, like the high spot. I can on my Garmin, I can do a 1 foot contours and shade, and I can find that little shell bar that everyone else that's lived there said no one knew about that place for all these years, and now these people didn't show up and catch them. That's technology, you know. So you know, it's like, where do you draw the line? I get that, you know, live sonar teaches you more than probably anything, but it's still just a tool. So, you know, to my argument to that is like, if we're going to get rid of sonar, live sonar, then we need to get rid of sight imaging. We probably just need to get rid of maps too. Maybe just go back to like the old school way. Cause when does it stop? You know what I mean? It's like, you know, for me, what live sonar has done, it's allowed me, and I know it's done this for Fred, it's allowed me to learn so much about the behavior of a bass and understand and fine tune an area that I'm fishing, you know, just like side scan did. I mean, what's the difference of me trolling motoring around with my side scan on and getting a picture of where this stuff is versus me just looking at it on live? And I get that you can see a fish floating in the water column, but that's not all year long that happens. That's a certain time of the year thing that's prevalent. But majority of people are using live sonar to find structure, just like we're using traditional sonar. I saw a funny video of Edwin Evers on Instagram the other day. Somebody was kind of making fun of the whole argument. And it had Edwin, and it was the ESPN clip, and it was, you know, Tommy Sanders talking about Edwin Evers is, you know, he's running down the lake and he stops in and he's 2D sonar, and he's trolling running around on his 2D with his rod in his hand, and he's dropping his bait down. He can see it on 2D. You can see his bait and you see the fish, and he's pulling his drop shot up, and the fish are just like we're doing, except I'm looking at him in front of my boat. He's just doing it right here, and everything, you know, that's exactly how they were doing it. He was staring at a screen the same way we're staring at a screen. And that's how we did it. I remember the first few times I went to Champlain and St. Clair, I trolling it around on 100, zigzagging back and forth with 2D sonar, looking for a blip on the screen. So it's just a different way of fishing now. And you know, again, I do kind of get it, but it's like, as technology grows, we have to adapt with that, you know. And I found an interesting magazine. Look at this magazine right here. This is called Point. It's a FLW magazine from 2004 called Point Man. And look at that old GPS. It's me there, Point GPS. And in the magazine, it's got an article, and it says 2004. It says, I put a GPS on the bow of my boat 3 years ago before I had seen anyone else do it. Might have been the smartest thing I've ever done. I was at Lake Okeechobee, and I realized that I needed to put a GPS on the front of my boat, because back then, in like 2000, we only had one GPS. It was at the console. Everybody else just had regular sonar at the front. And I put a GPS on the front of the boat so I could drop waypoints, fish right up to the waypoint. And I was utilizing that technology back in 2000, and it helped me win a lot of tournaments. It helped me catch more fish. And it was just, you know, just another technology thing that we've all adapted to. So when you look back at the last 20 years of bass fishing, you're going to see a lot of this same stuff that we're dealing with now. Again, live sonar is kind of the biggest thing that we've seen, obviously, but there's we've had examples of this for the last 20 years.
Scott, you make a lot of great points that resonate with me. It sounds to me like one of the things you're saying is this is not a difference of truly of kind of technology. It's a difference of degree. It's just kind of a natural advancement of what really started in 1957 with the Lowrance little green box.
Right.
It's just that people want to draw a line in the sand. Now, do they want to draw a line in the sand here because of the age of the average angler and they're not accustomed to this? Whereas 1930 and sonar comes along in 1957, they would have been pissed off about that.
Right.
Is that you think a fair statement?
Yeah, I do actually. I think, you know, there's a lot of people that have not, you know, taken this technology and utilized it to a certain degree. And, you know, it's kind of like social media in a way, you know, like I know a lot of people in the fishing industry that are mad at Instagram. Cause it's like, they don't want to do Instagram and Facebook cause they just don't understand it. They don't want to do it. So they're mad at the world that, you know, they're not getting any exposure or et cetera through social media. You have to adapt in any sport or anything that you're going to do. You're going to have to adapt to the technology. So, you know, but again, I say all that, but I do understand the argument and I understand the concern that people do have. But they're going to have to just figure out how to adapt with it. And I think we're going to be just fine.
Hey, Fred.
Yeah.
Most of the topic of the show is reactionary for what's going on in the Elite Series. Two events in and some pretty remarkable stuff from the rookie class. What's it like over on MLF? You got the same thing going on over there? Is there a lot of anti-forward-facing sentiment from veterans over there? What do you got?
I mean, you can look at what's going on at Red Crest right now and see that, you know, the guys that are players right now, they're scoping. I mean, they're definitely scoping. I do think that I would love for our league to have either just made up their mind numbers or five fish. I mean, that's just me, because I feel like, here's what I think. If we went back to a five fish limit, like, or 10 fish or seven, just limited it. It doesn't matter if you want to go scope or you want to go shallow. At the end of the day, you got to catch 10 fish, right? You got to get 10 of the right fish. So you could do what you want. But if the majority of the fish are out, it does make it a little harder for the guys that may want to go, you know, shallow. Now a big wave could move up shallow and those guys could hit it really well. But, I just look at that, what's going on right now. I don't think there's that much. But I also don't think a lot of our guys have as many live scopes on their boats as some of the Japanese guys I've seen over on the elite side either. You know, that I saw one where a guy had like seven of them on the boat, and I thought that was, I mean, I can't afford that, but you know, I thought that was a little much. But you know what? I've got sea brakes on the back of my power pole. So, I mean, are people going to complain about that? Cause I can reverse, you know, like I can back up, you know, if I go around scoping and I see something I like, I can back up and then throw at it without spooking the fish or leaving sight of it because my foot's still on the trolling motor. So, I mean, there's just, you know, that's the new thing. And once everyone starts catching on to that, they won't be talking about the forward facing sonar anymore. They're going to be talking about the sea brakes. So, I mean, I'll be honest with you. I think it's all great stuff. I love it. It does make it hard. I will say this. It makes it hard. I fished a team tournament with Jackson last weekend. We jumped in one. It makes it hard as a team when there's only one live scope on the boat. Because now,
oh, hell,
he's
yeah,
out there wanting to scope. I'm sitting there going, okay, those fish are down about 15 feet under the surface. I mean, yeah, there's one over there. Maybe there's one over here. One over, you know. So I'm doing the guesswork, the old school kind. But it still told me the depth, and every now and then I'll pluck one off. But no way could I compete if it was head-to-head with him. You know what I mean? Because he is catching everything that he sees. Which, you know, you don't want both guys throwing at the same fish. You're just trying to – now you're spooking them. But I also think, just like anything else that we do, we teach these fish, you know, they start getting conditioned. You know, I think you're going to start seeing fish move a little bit faster away from the screen. You know, and you're going to have to get even better and better to be able to stay ahead of the fish.
Are you saying
we're getting more educated for sure?
So, I mean, you just got to keep, you got to stay with it all. You got to, if you're not, if you let everything get too far ahead, then you're going to, in your mind, you feel like you can't catch up. And I think that's what's overwhelming most of the public. And it's really not that difficult if you get out there and do it.
You know, Scott, what were you going to say?
Yeah,
that I think these fish will obviously get a little more skittish on some of this. So as easy as it may look on TV right now with some of these events that we've had where these fish are kind of like we're discovering some of this new kind of way of catching some of these bigger ones offshore. I think, you know, those fish are going to adapt as well where they get a little shy of that transducer and it's going to become a little more hard and it'll probably swing a little. It's going to give a little bit more swing to the guys that are on the bank, cruising the bank. I think it's going to even itself out a little bit.
It will. It'll balance out. I promise you, it will.
Yeah, I think that'd be great because it would show some balance, as you say, Fred. But you know, our guests last week all said that they have never seen bass react adversely to the forward-facing sonar signal. That in every case, the fish either showed no change in behavior at all, or they move toward the signal, at least until they heard the waves lapping on the boat or something like that. That surprised me because I have heard some guys tell me they are seeing bass basically flee from the signal. Have y'all seen some of that already?
I've seen bass when you scope 100%, 90 feet away, find a fish, scope it for a second, gather your thoughts, gather your cast, kind of get your boat lined up, and that fish starts to feel the pressure and they of the sonar, not the boat, because they're still 90 feet away, and I've seen them push away. I've 100% seen it push away. So maybe they haven't, but I have for sure.
Yeah, I'm sorry, BTC. You had a question.
No, you nailed it, Ken. That was where I was going with it.
Well, now Fred mentioned a few moments ago that Scott, you and he had a chance to see the Garmin LiveScope stuff before it was released. Now it was released in 2018, won all the awards, just an absolute revolution out there. When you saw it, I'm guessing probably in 2017, did you have any idea it was going to have such an impact?
I did. I knew it was going to be special, but not to this degree. I don't think anybody envisioned it like this. I mean, I have a funny story. So this is how things develop, right? So I was at Lake Fork for the Toyota Bass Classic thing that they had. This was, I don't know, probably about 2018 time frame. And I had live scope on my boat. And I was literally down by the dam on that roadbed that Trey McKinney caught most of his fish the first couple of days of that tournament. It's a spot that I've always liked to fish. Mark Rose was there. I was there. And I was out off that drop. And I was throwing a football jig and dragging it off. And Mark Rose was throwing a big crankbait going back and forth. But I had my live scope on. And I was using the live scope really just for structure. And this big storm came through. And the fishing all of a sudden got really tough. There's no bass on the screen anymore. And I kind of had drifted off the spot quite a ways out, maybe 35 feet of water. And I was messing around doing something, and I looked over with my panoptics, and I just happened to see a blob on the screen at 10 feet down, 60 feet away, out over 35 feet of water. And I thought to myself, that must be a gar or a carp or something strange. It never clicked in my mind that it would be a bass. But I threw at it. I took a fluke. I had a big fluke, weightless, and I threw it over there and let it sink. I pulled some line off, let it sink down, and I watched the blob come up to the fluke, and I twitched it, and my line went tight. I set the hook, and I caught a 7-pounder. And I thought, how crazy is that? I just randomly caught this fish. Not clicking in my mind that these fish probably are doing this all over the lake. So then I looked around a little bit more, and I found another one. Anyways, I caught three or four of these big bass. Ended up with like a 30-something-pound bag. And Mark Rose was yelling over at me after he saw me catch the third or fourth one. And he's like, what are you throwing? What are you doing? And I said, I'm throwing a fluke on him. It just confused him. He didn't even know what to even think. And but at that time, I thought those fish suspended like that because of that weather that came through, this storm and this weird lightning and static in the air. And for all those years, I thought like it was just this perfect weather event that put these fish floating around out there in 35 feet of water. It never clicked in my mind that they were, at that time, fish were doing the same thing they're doing now. They're just out there suspended in different places. And, but anyways, that was in 2008. So again, I didn't know how to, you know, utilize live scope like we're utilizing it now. It's taken years for us to develop into those techniques. So it's not this magical live scope that's doing it. It's the technique of the live scope that we're developing, and these young kids are figuring out how to do it. I'm understanding perspective. We're always molding this. It's the same technology that we've had since 2018. It's just we're understanding it more. We're applying it in different ways in different places. So it's almost like we almost should, like, if we want to get rid of the sonar, we almost just say you can't fish in 35 foot of water anymore either. Like, I mean, like, that, because we're understanding how to utilize it and take advantage of it, of a technique. And it's almost like its own technique.
Yeah, Scott, I think we've even had it longer than that, because I remember the old brick, the big brick one. So that one shot like a 40 degree where ours was a 20.
Right.
And so do you remember that? And that was work. I was catching fish on Super Spooks back, I want to say like 2014 or 15 with that thing.
Yeah, it might have been. I've had them for a long time. And I remember the guys like Mark Rose, for example, in that tournament. He didn't have live scope on his boat. And a lot of guys didn't understand it back then. And I did, and a few guys did. But the majority of the FLW Tour at that time, professional anglers that fished offshore, did not utilize their live scope because they didn't quite understand it. And so there was a 3 or 4 year period there that I kind of had it a little to myself, and I definitely took advantage of that. And it helped me, you know, helped me win a few tournaments and helped me catch a few more fish along the way. And of course now everybody's got it, but it, you know, it wasn't like live scope's been around, like Fred said, for a long time.
Yeah. I was excited when we first went to the Bass Pro Tour, just for the fact that for that first year, I was one of the only ones with, I mean, there was a handful of us with it, but that was it. And it really hadn't taken off. So it helped me catch a lot of those checks right off the giddy, and helped me, you know, secure the, you know, the first red crest we had. But now everybody's got it, so everybody's getting good. And then, like you said, the techniques that are coming out, like I didn't really understand the sonar minnow style of fishing, you know, until about this year. I mean, I did it for crappie as soon as it came out. I remember going into the strip pits where I live at Lake Darnell and catching all the crappie. And back to what you were saying earlier, Ken, I actually watched crappie start spreading. Like I'd catch a couple out of school and they would disperse. So I actually kind of witnessed, you know, the fish getting conditioned. Maybe it was the way I was fishing. I don't know, but I saw them disperse. I'd chase them down. So I've got other ways of catching crappie, utilizing the technology, and finding, you know, multiple schools. But, there's just so much still to be learned. It's what's going on right now isn't what's going to be in 2 years. I promise you it's going to be better.
Yeah, I agree with that. I got to play devil's advocate here a little bit. The message board has a lot of the other side of the argument, and we're a little short on that because a lot of them guys didn't want to come on tonight. A lot. All of them.
Are you people mad? Is that what you're saying?
I think they're afraid of repercussions for things, but
yeah.
I think some guys have already lost some sponsorships or whatever, maybe. But one thing I keep seeing a lot, and I have two things here, but I'll throw the first one out, is cost, right? You know, it's expensive. Of course, you know, depends how deep you go. Freddie, you mentioned this earlier, guys, you know, with ridiculous amounts of units on their boat, et cetera. And it's a cost problem for you. You know, one thing I keep seeing on here is guys fishing the local stuff, the weekend angler stuff. Like, you know, those events are now being dominated by the handful of guys, you know, that have it. And you know, they're not happy about that. And I get that. So, I mean, for you guys competing, you have a little bit more the means to get it. But what's your thoughts on you know, what people say about how it's affecting their game? Because kind of presents a little bit of an, I don't know, unfair advantage maybe, but makes it more of a money thing.
Look, I'll say this. I totally understand about the crazy amount of units. Like if somebody said, you know, we got to make a change of some sort, and they said, what if we did like one unit for a tournament angler per boat? I'm not far off from saying that's okay. I think like Freddie said, these guys having 6 and 7 units on their boat, it's definitely in my mind like a little bit overkill and scary, and it just kind of probably not a good thing really. Just for that, I mean, they have $100,000 worth of electronics on their boat, and the average guy can't, you know, do that. And then that just gives them a reason to be resentful or an excuse of why they didn't catch them, because, you know, this guy's got all these sonar things going on, and I get it. So, you know, I don't think we need 6 or 7, you know,
no,
it's on our boat to be with you. I mean, they're only using the front one at the, when they're fishing and practice, they might use all these other different, you know, transducers to find the fish, but in the, when it's game day, they're pretty much using the front one anyways.
Do you anticipate rule changes? Scott, start with you.
I know there's a lot of talk about it. I mean, it's, I think something, there's a lot of passionate anglers that are definitely on the other side of this. And I totally get it. When we have this debate with other people, I totally understand. I'm not sitting here thinking that they're wrong in their thoughts and the way they feel. So I think there'll be some changes. I don't know. I don't think they're going to ban live scope, by any means, but they may restrict it to some degree, you know, just for the optics of it, literally and figuratively. So that's probably where the leagues will probably go, I would imagine, at some point. You know, you know, again, the argument of affording a live scope unit, and, you know, you're going to have most people that's, you know, going to be serious about fishing a tournament, you're going to have a GPS unit on your boat, most likely. You're going to have a 10 or 12 inch unit on your boat. So the added expense for a $1,400 sonar box and a transducer is a lot of money. But at the same time, I don't think that holds water to say like we shouldn't have it because guys can't afford one transducer and one black box to put on their boat when they have a $3,500 Ultrex trolling motor or a Garmin Force trolling motor with spot lock and all the crazy stuff and power poles on the back of your boat. So, you know, again, going back to like that argument saying like, oh, well, it's just too much money and guys can't afford it and it's taken away from true. All right. So let's get rid of spot lock and let's get rid of power poles and let's get rid of, you know, you basically need to go back to this small little unit right here, this whole 7-inch screen, and I'll be okay. So it's like, I get it, but it's, you know, so I think if we regulated the amount of them in tournaments, mm-hmm. could help the argument to some degree.
Yeah, and when I said I couldn't afford earlier, that I was referring to like 7 of them on the boat. That wasn't talking about having 1 or 2. I mean, I like having a perspective. I like having a forward facing. You know, having both of them, it gives you that double option. But like Scott said, I think, you know, we have limitations on our outboard engines. We've got 250 horse for our tournaments. You know, if we got to start drawing the line on a competition boat of what is acceptable at what boundaries, you know, I mean, NASCAR, you know, everything's got a limitation of a realm that you can compete with. So I do think you can't, I just don't think you should get rid of it. I really don't. I don't think it's here. And maybe I'm just saying this because I'm also thinking I want a lot of guys to do that because I'm still going to go because I've got what got me here, right? I've got the techniques that, and when certain things happen to the weather and the circumstances and the experience, and you just have that instinct when you need to go to the bank, right? So that's what keeps us competitive versus maybe the guys that are just, you know, doing just the one thing is knowing.
Well, you know. I expect we can all agree that there's no way that any of the leagues are going to ban this stuff.
No.
I mean, you've got Johnson Outdoors, Garmin, and Lowrance standing in the way of that. And that is a lot of sponsorship money. Mm-hmm. Nobody is going to piss those people off. I think that's pretty clear. But you do have the leagues considering restricting it in some way. I don't think it's any big secret that Bass has created a committee of some anglers and the elites to talk about what they might do to restrict it in some way, whether it's number of transducers or something else. And I'm a guy who does not like the idea of restricting technology because I don't think we get anywhere generally by restricting technology. I think that the industry is best served if we let technology play and see where it goes. I also think that when you reduce technology, you hold the industry back in some way. I remember that for until the mid-90s, BASS restricted outboard motors to 150 horsepower, which meant that bass boats were not going to be bigger, which meant because they weren't going to be using the bigger motors. And I feel like that held the marine industry back for a while. So that's kind of why where I'm at on this, I don't want to see them restrict the technology. But if they did move in that direction, where do you guys think the attitude of the anglers you compete with is? Would most of them be in favor of some restrictions? Would most of them be in favor of no restrictions? Any idea how that lands? Fred?
I think ultimately we all just want to compete with the same tools. Does that make sense? Like, I get we all have different lures, different techniques, but we want to have our boats rigged out kind of similar. I think we should all have live scope or forward-facing sonar. I'm not saying don't. I absolutely love it. I think it's opened our eyes to a whole nother experience in fishing, which makes it fun, and ultimately that's why we're doing it. But I don't want to stop the progression of the sport by any means. I actually kind of think maybe three. You know, limit to three. Here's what the third one is. The third one's on the back corner that's facing that direction. You could look at while you're idling. You know, you can use it for that purpose. But then when you have someone else in the boat, a team tournament or a co-angler, they've got something to look at on your back graph, right? It just makes it fun for everybody. So I'm kind of looking after them too. But if, you know, seven's extreme. You got to admit, seven's extreme.
Yeah.
Now, if they do come out with one that does a full 360 everything around you, I mean, heck, that's an advancement in technology.
It's like pulling up the skirt, you know what I mean? Just
I mean, if they can show the whole playing field, show the whole playing field, but make
that's
it make
I'm talking
it,
about.
Yeah, I mean,
Scott, what do you think? Scott, among your elite peers, what do you think would be the majority attitude? Keep it, no restrictions, ban it outright, something in the middle?
I think the majority of people would say leave it the way it is or make some small restrictions, at least, again, like, and when I say restrictions, I don't mean like, you know, maybe one or two transducers on your boat. You know, that's probably acceptable. But, you know, the old school guys, I mean, there is a group of those old school guys for sure that are get rid of it. You know, they're definitely boisterous about it. And again, I, you know, I'm here supporting live sonar. I've been with Garmin for a long time. I love what I've learned as a fisherman by looking at it, but I do understand. I get their frustration with it, but I think you know, it's kind of like anything else. Over time, they'll adapt, just like we've had to adapt. You know, you got to figure it out a little bit. And once they do, then their attitude's going to change.
Yeah.
If I give my mother-in-law my iPhone and tell her to do something with it, she has no clue what's going on. If I give my mother-in-law my iPhone right now and say, you know, send me a text message or anything, like, it's not going to happen. And she doesn't want it. You know what I mean?
It's I'm doing a podcast with Ken. I know what you mean.
That was an unfair shot. That was totally unfair. Well, I thought this was a TV show. You told me this was television.
Yes.
That's why I got the suit. Come on.
That's why you're all dressed up. As far as restrictions, what we heard last week, I think it was, I think it might've been Milliken brought, or maybe it was Alton brought it up, but it alluded to the number of graphs, and visual or sight impairment, you know. And I remember Ben kind of laughed about running into some buoys, you know, over the past year, looking at graphs. So from a safety perspective, considering limiting the number of graphs that are blocking your sight lines, which makes sense, right? You know, they don't allow you to tape your front windshield on your car, let alone put a bunch of TVs in front of it. The other argument that I saw on the message board here regarding the local tournament guys, and I thought it was a very good point. He says, you know, as a working man, you know, with forward facing, you don't need to take off 3 days to practice. So he says, I love it. It's worth it. That's a good point. Yeah.
Point.
Yeah.
You know,
will anybody plan a brush pile ever again now that anybody on lake with this technology will find it like that? I used to plan a lot of brush piles, guys, back in the day. No more.
I would definitely agree with that. I think there's less people putting brush piles out because it's like, why am I going to do all this work for somebody to find it in 5 minutes?
Yeah.
And not only that, you can catch the thing roaming instead of break it off in a brush pile.
Yeah.
Go ahead, man. Well, I was going to say, a friend of mine just texted me, Brian Head from the Bass Tank, just texted me and said, didn't they try to ban flipping back in the 70s? But they really didn't. There was no serious effort to ban flipping. I can't remember if it was Scott or Fred earlier mentioned I think it was Fred mentioned in the back of the boat, you don't necessarily have a lot going on. Because if you don't have a screen and the live scope unit out there, you're kind of blind casting. There was a similar complaint back in the 70s about flipping because the guy on the front of the boat is picking everything apart and he's 8 feet from it. And the guy in the back has got relatively nothing to fish. So it's similar in that respect. Mm-hmm. And I'm grateful they didn't ban flipping. My God, I think that from 1975 until about maybe 2019, 2020, that was sort of the flipping era of bass tournaments. If you didn't have a flipping stick, you could not compete. And now have we entered a new era with forward facing?
Oh yeah.
What do you think, guys? Is this the forward facing?
Yeah, I think I'm gonna need to add one to the back so when I fish teams with my kid, I got something to look at.
Frog fishing's over, Fred. You gotta rebrand yourself.
Funny because we do fish so differently. I mean, I enjoy explosion topwater fishing. Granted, I gotta, you know when you can do it in a tournament and compete, and you know when you can't. So there's that. But just fun fishing. We're not talking competition fishing. I'm still gonna go out there and throw my buzz baits, frogs, and swim baits and do it old school. You know, I'm gonna use live scope and now mostly perspective mode in that shallow stuff. And it's, you know, it's just another application, another tool. I mean, I just love catching bass. I'll be honest with you.
that passion shows. It's one of the things I love about. That's the thing I love about Fred Roumbanis is the passion shows through. Scott, what do you think? Is the flipping era over, and is it now the live scope era?
We're definitely in a different era for sure, but I think that's a good point you bring up because I mean it's like there's over the course of the history of bass fishing we've seen things like this progress. I mean I remember. Again, 15 years ago, sight fishing tournaments in FLW, there might have been 5 people in a sight fishing tournament or when the fish were up shallow spawning, 5 people on the whole tour that would even attempt to go do it. And now when the stars align and we go to a lake that's classified as a good sight fishing deal, you've got 80% of the field doing it. You know, it's the same thing, you know, and so, with live sonar, it's the same thing. It's not going to go away. People are going to keep developing ways to catch it with live sonar or fish. But I think it's going to even itself out a little bit. Mm-hmm. I really do. You know, I think people are going to start like Fred said, having that ability to be able to go to the bank, you're not always going to, that might not always be the best way of catching fish. You know, we've seen it in this pre-spawn deal, and I get it. And there's certain times of the year that's going to be, it's going to look really easy and kind of so non-traditional where you're swimming around in open water. But there's a lot of the year and a lot of lakes we go to that we're just using that sonar very traditionally, looking for a brush pile, looking for a lay down, or looking for some type of bait fish or something like that that allows us to fish those areas and then subsequently catch the fish, but not necessarily targeting an individual fish. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what's ruffled the feathers. We ended last season offshore at a smallmouth fishery, okay? And we're all doing it. And again, going back, I promise you, if we were all at the St. Lawrence River 15 years ago, and there's guys throwing chatterbaits and all that up on the bank, but the majority of people be drifting that river with their 2D sonar looking for a blip on the screen and chasing blips down on the screen. They'd be out in the open water lake, zigzag miles an hour on their trolling motor looking for a boulder. And when they found a boulder, they would stop, they would see a mark under their boat, and they'd fish for it. They'd chase that mark around. It's the same thing. It's just now we're looking a little forward, you know, 60, 70. So we've just evolved in the way that we're doing it. And so if we get rid of it, you know, the argument of like, I'm tired of looking at everybody's, you know, back of their head looking at the screen. Well, guess what? They're still going to be doing it. We're still going to be doing that, especially now knowing what we know lives out there.
Yeah. Here's one thing I don't like about Ken. I'm going to have to talk over you on this one. I'm sorry.
Go for it, man. Go for it.
I apologize. One thing I don't like about it as a fan, I liken it to MLF. When a year or two into you know, Major League Fishing, the anglers figured it out. All you got to do is throw a wacky rig. And every event, it was all about that, right? So, again, from a fan, from a viewer standpoint. And listen, I'm from Jersey, dude. I'm used to throwing a spinning rod. I got no problem with it. But it became a league that, like, well, shit, I'm not going to see anybody flipping or punching or throwing a glide bait or big, you know, anything like that. So it became very one-dimensional in that respect. And you know, that was, you know, the every fish counts thing. And
it was only a 1 pound minimum back then too.
Yeah. And I just found that to be kind of dull. Like, this is just really repetitive. The same techniques, the same baits. And like, clearly you're not going to have the size issue with forward facing, but it does seem to be in a big way kind of changing that. Now, clearly there's guys out there catching them with other big baits like Milken is, or the jig that the maniac from Maine is doing. But that's one thing that, like, I don't love that aspect of it. You know, it's just seeing all the same baits.
That's
all I got.
I do understand that, and I to a degree understand that totally. So and I see it, but I'm hopeful that things will even itself out a little bit, and we'll see the development of perspective. We'll see the development of people utilizing sonar shallow, and then that's going to take away a little of that feel, because we're going to be fishing more traditional ways and baits up shallow, utilizing our sonar. And it's going to look a little more, I think it's going to look a little bit more normal, I think, you know, over time, because people are going to start utilizing it up in different ways, like we already have.
I agree with that. Mm-hmm. Right, Ken, now you may go, Ken.
Thank you. I love Scott's observation about the really going from a vertical analysis now to a horizontal analysis, because I think that for whatever reason, that has fired up so many people. Now, the technology came out and was introduced to the public in 2018, but it seems to me it's really only been last year and this year that people are so fired up about it, and it's become so dominant in the sport as far as a conversational piece, as far as a controversy piece. Has it just taken everybody that long to get that skilled with it, or for a group of anglers who are that skilled with it to rise up and get to the elites and get to BPT and make it so prominent? Why has it been 5 and 6 years before it really seemed to become a hot button topic?
you said it right there. It's the age of the anglers now. It's that mentality of the new thing. They're starting to understand it more again. Because again, when I was utilizing it 5, 6, 7, 8 years ago, I would look around on the boats at blast off, and we didn't have that many guys utilizing it. And so now, you know, they are, and so, you know, the younger generation has taken that technology and ran with it. You know, and look, the leagues also can do a little bit of their part of scheduling some of these tournaments on some fisheries that forward-facing sonar might not be as relevant or a big a deal, you know, but when we go to these smallmouth fisheries, I mean, it's just the way it's going to be. And I think last year we did 3 tournaments in a row between St. Clair, Champlain, and the St. Lawrence River. And then that got everybody fever pitched over it. And then we started off this year, you know, with it again. And but I think as we get into some of these other events throughout the year, I think it's going to, you know, there'll be other ways to catch them, you know, for sure.
I just don't think that a lot of people realize what bass did in the wintertime until about this year, mostly this year, when they realize that those big bass will actually sun out in the middle of the lakes, come up high in the water columns, and you can catch them 10, 15 feet down. I didn't know that. I honestly, if I threw out and caught one like that, I thought it was a lucky fluke fish. You know what I mean? Until now. So I think a lot of eyes were open to it. So people are doing that. And then that's where everyone's getting all bent out of shape, because they think that's the only way you can catch a bass now. And it's not true. It's just that time of the year, that situation. And like you said, Scott, you guys had 3 smallmouth fisheries in a row. Everybody did it then. And then you start the season off where people have learned a new technique and how it's working. I mean, it's really cool. And I mean, I wish I knew more about it going into the season. I'd have done a whole lot better at Toledo Bend, even though I did catch one on live scope, an 8-pounder, but I caught it 42 foot down on the bottom in a brush pile, not floating up high.
Right.
So the ones I did catch, actually, I did catch several of them up high, but I figured it out way too late in the game. And that was so cool to learn that and understand it. And my kid's been doing that for 2 years. At these little lakes, I mean, I just figured it was the lake. This fish don't get pressure, you know. I just didn't realize that this is what bass do. So, I mean, for somebody that's done it, I've fished tournaments for 20 years now professionally, and I didn't know that. So, I mean, it's you can't get upset about it. You got to be happy and be like, wow, dude, this is like opening our eyes to new ways of fishing. So I'm excited to start the year off, because I've never caught them. Like, I always bomb the first term of the year. It's been like just – it's almost like I just know I got to climb to make a championship. And it's just always a climb throughout the year, because I understand what the fish do after the wintertime. And a lot of it's because we sell our boats. We don't have boats, you know, in between seasons. So now I understand a little bit more. And I'm excited to, you know, obviously finish off this season, but then go forward into the winter tournaments knowing a new way of catching bass. So, I mean, I don't know. I'm just talking through my experiences.
I just want to jump in real quick and clarify something I had said earlier about the double-digit numbers of guys that were going to come on and did or whatever. The pressure's not just from sponsors. It's also from the fans. These guys were also reacting to the negative feedback they were receiving from fans on social media, on Facebook, on YouTube. You guys on YouTube comment right now, like, you know, guys that complained about it up on stage got hammered for it, you know, on social media. And so yeah, it's not just sponsors and people doing what they're told. That's all.
Yeah,
back to you, Mr. Duke.
There's a lot of opinions and everybody's got one.
Mm-hmm. Oh my god.
Right.
yes they do. I'm getting a beer. Anybody want one?
Guys, I apologize. I'm having some connectivity issues here, but I hope you can hear me. Both of you guys made a great comment that I really enjoyed. You talked about how much you're learning because of forward-facing sonar. Can you give us some examples? Because I think that might be the strongest argument for keeping the technology in the game.
Yeah, for me, understanding how fish react to bait fish how they react to certain types of weather conditions where these fish are on the bottom, or they're in brush, or they're on top of brush. They're around brush, not in the brush. Some days they're in the brush. Some days they're around it completely. I've learned so much just seeing that and how fish react. And to be honest with you, I was in my mind probably wrong more than I was right on what I thought the fish were doing. And now I'm starting to really start to understand how these fish react. And also how, like in the past, when you would fish a spot you weren't catching them because they obviously left, but you don't know that because you're just sitting there and you think, well, maybe I need to change colors of my lure or change a different technique to react, get those fish to react. The whole time they're not there. And so what I've realized now allowed me to make better decisions quicker. Fish are pretty aggressive, what I've learned. Like, you know, I can roll through several different techniques on a pretty quick pace. And if I don't get a bite or two, it's because they're not there. It's not because they were that finicky or, you know, they're just sitting there looking at you with their, you know, shooting their fin up at you, like get lost. But, you know, those fish have vacated the area and then it allows me to see kind of where they go. And it just, understanding their behavior is very interesting. Again, what I used to think and what I know now by seeing it and feeling it is really a lot different than what I thought for all those years, to be honest with you. So, I don't have a specific example other than just, I'm just amazed a lot of times, like, wow, you know, they're not there anymore and they're over here doing this thing. And, you know, just different ways that these fish are reacting.
Yeah. Ken? All right. Did we lose him? Nah, ain't gotcha.
What's that?
Ken, do you have something? So overall, where do you feel like, you know, the question was thrown out, is this, you know, the direction you want the sport to go? I think Matt Arry threw that out on his live stream yesterday. Is this the direction we want the sport to go? Yes or no? Freddie?
Hey, I mean, I think it's going to balance out. I think we need to give it some more time. I think, you know, people are kind of jumping the gun thinking this is the only way you can catch a bass. And I know it's not true. You know, without giving up too much details of what I got going on this season, but I want everybody to go out there in some situations. You know what I'm saying? Like there's going to be tournaments where I think a little more instinct might make a little bit a little bit better decisions.
Yep.
But you know, I don't have a problem with it at all. I don't have a problem with it at all. You know, I just,
what do you think, Scott?
It's too early to tell, really. I think it's just going to progress. I think Freddie made a great comment a minute ago. What we see right now versus what we're going to see in 2 years from now is going to be totally different. And again, with the way that people are understanding how to catch fish, utilizing sonar and giving them, you know, the ability to make better decisions on the water, are going to spread people out shallow and deep a little bit. So I don't know. I think it's fine. Again, I've always been a supporter of the technology, and we'll just have to see. I don't think we need to make any quick snap decisions that this is the end of traditional bass fishing. I think we need to just let it run its course a little bit and let's see what happens.
You back, Ken?
These are the end times, Scott Martin. It's all over now because of forward-facing sonar. We know exactly who the devil is. No, I'm kidding.
I mean, ultimately, we want it to be fun for our fans. You know, we want our fans to enjoy
Absolutely. It. And, you know, one of the things that frustrates me about a lot of the naysayers, the guys who are trying to get it banned, is I wonder how many of them are really trying to keep up with the times and learn the technology and utilize it versus just falling back on their old methods, which are now no longer as effective. Do you guys think that's part of the problem?
Of course.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Of course. You know, if there was one thing to ban, if there was one thing to ban in all of tournament
Senkos.
Fishing, all levels, I would say ban a net. Net. I just, really? I feel like.
Come on now.
What got me excited about bass fishing as a little kid was watching Bassmasters and watching those guys go down and land fish with their hands. Like, to me, that is the coolest thing. Like, going down and landing. You know, once you hook them, that's the battle. That's the sport, right? You landing that fish. To me, I think if you're going to ban something, ban a net. Don't ban live scope.
Fred, you're approximately a million times better bass fisherman than I am. But to me, it's the bite. If I can make the fish bite, I feel like I've accomplished it. As far as nets go, I would ask you to talk to some biologists. I think most of them will tell you that if you were to use a rubberized net that's wet, obviously, and it's going to be wet as you dip the fish out of the water, that is better fish care than boat flipping them by a wide margin. And you'll cut fatalities down pretty dramatically and infection. So I wish there were nets at y'all's level, at the highest level. And I like what Major League Fishing does with their fish care penalties and stuff like that. Not let the fish hit the carpet or the clothes and stuff like that. That's good stuff. And I apologize, guy. I've had some technical difficulties on my end, but I'm going to jump in and say a non sequitur here. It just occurred to me while we were doing the show, in the middle of the show, that it's Roland Martin's birthday. He's 84 years old. And going strong like crazy. So, Scott, to your dad, happy birthday. Didn't mean to halt the show, but longtime hero, I expect, of all of ours. And Sola going amazingly strong to 84. So, more power to Roland.
Happy birthday, Roland.
Happy birthday, Roland.
Happy birthday, Pops.
There you go. Absolutely. That's awesome. Now, I love that you guys are saying that this is a learning opportunity with the forward facing, because to me, that's the strongest argument to keep it in the sport at the highest levels. Because if you guys are learning from it, imagine what the rest of us can gain from it. But one of the assaults I hear fairly consistently about forward facing sonar is what it's doing in the crappie fishing world. Guys are going and finding a school of 30 crappie and catching every last one of them and potentially decimating the populations. Now, Fred, you mentioned that you do some crappie fishing and you use your forward facing on that. It's got to be very effective, am I right?
Yeah, I mean, with crappie, you know, they have like crazy limits of crappie. Like you can get 30. To me, I mean, I can feed my family fine with like 12, you know, so, and that's probably more than we need anyway. So I, you know, maybe they just limit the amount of crappie that they're fishing for. That would be my answer to that situation. These guys are going out catching 30 every single time. But
especially a fish like a crappie, people like to catch their limit. People like to throw some in the freezer.
They do.
And I wonder how many people are going to be that great stewards of the resource. The bass world has been, we had a show about this actually, has catch and release gone too far? Because every biologist I talk to tells me that catch and release on too far. We need to be consuming some of these fish, but I don't think there's the same attitude or the same ethic with regard to crappie fishing. So I worry about them. I wonder if they're the canary in the coal mine for the sport.
Yeah, but we learn so much from the crappie fishermen, though. A lot of the things that we're doing, I mean, if you look at the way they're the minnow stuff, that's a lot of crappie technique. You know what I mean? The way that they're catching these bass up high. It's the crappie fishermen. I mean, I got sea breaks on, like I said, on my power poles, which is going to be the new topic, because that's what, so the crappie guys could throw 16th ounce baits with the wind to their back and stay off, you know, and still get those fish on top of the brush piles. So we can use those applications in bass fishing. So, I mean, they're actually pretty advanced in what they do.
Who knew?
Yeah. Crappie, right?
Crappie. Yeah. They're crappie or competitor or largemouth. So, I think in the short term, it's probably going to be good for bass fishing.
Yeah.
Crappie's the only species that I know of that has like five different names. Like a bass is a bass.
Right.
Crappie sockle. And specks and sockeye, perch. They call them all kind of stuff.
It's just calico bass.
Yeah.
They are delicious, though. Gosh, they're delicious.
They are delicious, yes.
Hey, look, it's Frozen Ken.
Sorry, guys. I'm having a lot of technical issues. I think I'm going to sit and listen the best I can and let BTC take it from here. He's the smart one anyway. He's not the well-dressed one, but he is the smart one.
The fuck I am. How dare you, Ken?
Sure. I got a question for Scott. Do you run the transducer, the saltwater transducer? Was it the?
I do. I have one of those on. Everybody's been asking me about that. I don't think it's that big of. Honestly, I don't think. I think it's not. Yeah. It's not some groundbreaking as far as bass fishing goes. I mean, it's designed for saltwater for a reason. So, I mean, I've got it on there, but it's. I mean, the 34 is a better, sharper picture, to be honest with you, for what we do.
Okay, I was just contemplating getting one when I go up north. That's all.
Yeah, I mean, you can see a little farther. Obviously, it's a stronger beam, but you lose. It's not as defined of a picture. But for like looking for fish farther away from the boat in open water, I mean, definitely get a little bit better.
It uses the same box.
It does. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yep. Yep. Yep.
So, is it a technological advancement or a youth movement?
I think it's both.
It's certainly both. It's.
I think it's even right down the middle. I think you, Trey McKinney, and I don't know Trey that well, but I know of Trey, and I've heard the stories. Trey's been fishing at a high level from the time he was 14 years old, fishing high school tournaments and tournaments, and going out there and putting his time in, and that he knows how to fish, and so do so many. My daughter, she's not using live scope. I mean, she's started using it a little bit lately, but she's 18 years old, and since she was 15 years old doing these high school tournaments, she was just so far advanced from where I was at 15.
Mm-hmm.
With every technique, I would say, hey, try a drop shot. She would instantly pick up a drop shot and start catching fish, and like doing everything right, jerk baits, all these different techniques. It took me years to figure out. These kids are learning them in a few minutes, and not because they're sitting there researching the internet. Like, I mean, they do get great advice and great. They get to see it on the internet, and they get to see, like, when you like, you can read an article about how to do a technique, and it's different than when you see it. It is certainly different when you're experiencing the boat too. So, all of these young anglers are just that much more on the water at a young age, and they're experiencing tournament fishing. Like we experienced tournament fishing at 14, 15, 16, that speaks volumes in itself.
Yes, it does.
I won a tournament, my first tournament at 22 years old. FLW person never won one at the time. I think someone's beat that since then. But, you know, I was considered like at 22 years old, I was like, everybody's like, oh, he's just a kid. And these guys now at 22, I didn't know anything at 22. These kids now.
They know everything.
Thing and they're darn good at it. So
they are.
That's true.
Sonar and technology to help them. Absolutely. If you take it away from them, I think you'd be really surprised at how well they're going to fish and adapt to things. Mm-hmm. Understand? Because they've been doing it at this level. That's what you got to understand. That's what high school fishing did and college fishing did. It allowed anglers to make game day decisions and fish at a high level at 14, 15 years old and on. That did not happen when I was a kid. There was no 15-year-old kids fishing tournaments at that level when I was a kid. Like basically, that didn't happen.
And even that, if you don't mind me chiming in, live. They can watch live all day long for two different tours and see what the top guys are doing, because the top guys are the guys with the camera. So you could sit there and watch what they're doing. And if you're not learning something from that, I mean, you are. That's the thing. That's what's going on. These kids are learning. I could, just like Scott said, Jackson, my son, at 15 years old, bought a kayak on a Wednesday, took it out for the first time on a Thursday after school for a tournament on Saturday, a Hobie tournament, and won it. No, nothing in the boat. Three fishing rods, a little tackle box, a rope, and an anchor. And that's all, and the paddles. There's no electronics on it. But he went out there and beat all professional kayakers from all the way up from Canada, New York, to all over the place in a Hobie tournament. And the reason he won is because he knew through experience at that age, because he fishes every day, time on the water. And I'm sure watching all the live and all that helps as well. So these kids are definitely, there's just a lot more resources. When we were younger, there was no live, there was no internet, there was no GPS. There was no, I mean, there wasn't anything when we first started. It was, you know, trying to dial in a lure to make it work the best. You know, that was your edge, was your lure.
Yep.
Anyway, that was...
Ken, you there?
Guys, I'm having such a hard time hearing what's going on, but I do have I'll try to get a question in. Maybe it could be heard. Yeah. You guys are clearly doing really well for the mature, highly accomplished guys, and you're adapting to forward-facing sonar better than most of your peers. Do you have some sympathy or understanding for your peers, some of the guys 40 years plus, who feel like their careers may be ending because of this technology?
I think that's just a mindset for them. I'll be honest with you. I think that's their own mindset. If they don't want to, you know, get with it and start adapting and learning, because it's really fun once you do, then that's, you know, a mindset. For me, I'm still going to do what got me here. I'm still going to do it. I'm going to check it out in practice. But if it's not, in my mind, competitive, I'm going to do what's going to make it competitive so I have a shot. I mean, that's just – and that's me telling myself what I have to do. And it's hard because there's been situations like Guntersville last year when I knew it was an offshore deal, but I also knew the temperatures were right to throw a frog. And I went up there and threw a frog. Unfortunately, I missed on a few opportunities that should have made the knockout round. So, I mean, I did what I felt I could have done, and I balanced it. I just zigged when I should have zagged, you know. So, I mean, there's decisions to make. And when you make those right decisions and it all comes together, I feel like I'm that close to getting it dialed again, you know, doing both.
Hey, Scott, what do you think? You hear it from a lot of your peers that think this is the great Satan. Are these guys, do you feel some sympathy for, or do you think, hey, they just need to buckle down, work with it, and learn it?
Again, I know I'm talking in circles here because 1 minute I'm like all, you know, talking about how great it is. But I do understand the frustration, and they do have to adapt. But I do understand the frustration. There's a lot of guys that are really, really good with a spinnerbait. There's a lot of guys that are really, really, really good with a jig. And there's a lot of guys that are really good with a jerkbait and a drop shot. And everybody's got their own little lane. And I do appreciate that talent that these anglers have. We've seen it over the years. You know, yeah. I wasn't as good with a drop shot as Aaron Martin. I'll never be as good as Aaron Martin's was with a drop shot. But he was special with that. I'm never going to be as good as fisherman with a frog as Freddie is with a frog. He's got that dialed in. Like, he knows things about that technique that I don't know. So I appreciate Dave Brower with the jig. I appreciate those techniques and that mastery that these guys have developed over the years. And so I understand that feeling where they're like, man, it doesn't mean anything anymore. I get that. You just have to adapt. And I think what Freddie said again is interesting. I think the guys that can learn how to utilize this technology and lean on their traditional skill sets that they've honed in on, those guys that can balance that a little bit might be the most deadly guys on tour, because there's coming a day where these fish are not going to react the same way they're reacting that they are right now. I'm telling you right now, and there's going to be guys that develop other things and understand how to use their sonar in a completely different way other than chasing down a blob out in open water. And I think we got to give it some time to see how it develops.
Well said. Well said.
Very well said. Great observation there. I just got a great question from Stephen Barden, who is the biologist, of course, for Major League Fishing, also one of the leading private biologists, lake management guy, former guest on Bass After Dark. He said he wants to know if that a fisheries agency, a state fisheries agency, were to go in and ban forward-facing sonar, do you think many professional anglers would step up and try to make public comment or otherwise weigh in to support forward-facing sonar?
I think your
camp have that kind of support.
I think it's split down the middle, to be honest with you. I think there's going to be a lot of guys that would throw their hands up and be upset about it, and I think there'd be a lot of guys applauding at this point. But again, we're just in the first couple of years of where this is going, and let's just see what happens. I think people are going to be pleasantly surprised at how this all develops over the next year or two.
Ken, that's a unique question. Steve said, if we were to go to a lake or, you know, in a state where it did get banned, heavens, you know, I hope it doesn't, but if there would be events where we could use it and couldn't use it, maybe that would be the balance that guys want it, you know. I don't know. I mean, that would be interesting if that were to happen.
Yeah.
I hope we don't not go to lakes because, you know, for any reason, you know what I mean?
I hope you don't go to tournaments anymore.
Yeah.
Because,
yes.
Jesus.
Everybody catches a limit. They all weigh the same. 50th place and first place are separated by 2 ounces per fish. Yeah. Come on. Don't end the season with a smallmouth tournament, guys. Not that you guys are in control of the schedule. But
and again, I get it. As the anglers, it's fun as hell. But from a viewer's standpoint, personally, and it's mid-season, so like, you know, the excitement for watching fishing starts to dwindle a little bit. But oh god, not another smallmouth tournament where everybody's drop shotting, or now they'll be minnowhead, whatever. Carry on.
I asked this question of our panel. I have
to report here in a minute. My wife came in and I have to go with her. We have to go do something. So. I am going to have to jump off this awesome podcast here in just a minute. We probably got time for one more question, or I can hang out for about another minute, but I do have to cut y'all short. I apologize.
No, it's fine.
I got one more question for both of you. Scott, I'll lead with you here. Is forward-facing sonar leveling the playing field, and is it reducing luck from tournament success?
I don't know.
For years, we tried to remove luck.
I don't know. I think luck's still there. I mean, like, because, you know, when you're utilizing, you know, your sonar, you know, you might luckily find a brush pile that you didn't know was there, obviously. So that's kind of lucky a little bit. It's not like my brain said, like, I'm going to, you know, need to look over there for that brush pile. But, you know, I think it evens the playing field a little bit. It allows people to. I think it evens the playing field for sure. I think it does, you know, because guys are able to utilize that technology. They're able to find fish a little bit quicker. You know, we've only got a couple days of practice typically in these tournaments. You know, it cuts down on a lot of dead time on locating where you think you want to fish the tournament. So it allows you to make a better game plan a little quicker than in the past. But look, it's not magic. It's not magic. I spent time at Lake Fork looking for fish offshore. I knew that's how guys were going to catch them. I never found them. I looked around, and I feel like I'm pretty good at using my sonar. I did not find those fish. So it's not like you know, this misconception of, like, you just turn your forward-facing sonar on and put your trolling motor down. It's like all these fish are just everywhere. You just catch them at will. You know, like, I spent 3 days at Lake Fork looking. I caught zero big bass offshore. I caught crappie and everything else. I could not figure them out. And when you look at it on live, it looks easy. You look at it on live and you go, oh my gosh, these guys are just catching them. It just makes sense. They're just over there just catching them all the time. There's, you know, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100 people in that tournament that didn't catch them. You know, so it's is it a way to win tournaments? Absolutely. Has it dominated a handful of events? Absolutely. But so does a lot of different techniques. But we're not all just out there wrecking the fish every 5 seconds on forward-facing sonar. It's a technique of using it. It's a technique that you got to understand and utilize, and it's not easy.
Yeah, and at the end of the day, you got to put yourself around the fish. I mean, that's where I screwed up at Toledo Bend. I mean, I just never got around them, like you said, at Lake Fork. You know, had I been around them, maybe I'd had a better event there. It's just another tool.
Hey, Scott, we're going to let you go. We know you're in a hurry here, but, Scott. Thank you so much, for Scott Martin, for joining us. We appreciate you, brother.
Thank you,
guys. See you on the road soon.
Thanks, Scott.
And then there was one, Freddie Boom Boom is still with us. And sometimes I can hear what everybody's saying and sometimes I can't. But Fred, I want to go back to that luck thing. Because, you know, for as long as there have been bass tournaments, I feel like the rules have tried to eliminate luck. You know, there's no live bait. There's no trolling. There's no Alabama rig. No this, no that. And I think they're all kind of honing us toward removing luck. Does forward-facing sonar help us do that?
No, my kid still makes me Lucky Rice Krispie treats, finds lucky four-leaf clovers, gets me. We make sure we don't have any bad luck bananas in the boat. I mean, you know, no, I don't think it does anything like that. I think
you don't think it helps us eliminate luck. To me, that would be a good reason for keeping it.
Yeah,
makes it more skillful.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I've never really felt like, I'll be honest with you, the luck side of fishing has never been a big issue to me. Like, I felt like it always came down to hard work, understand what's going on.
Making your luck. Out.
What's that?
Yeah. You make your luck.
Yeah. I've been waiting for that luck for a lot of years now to win a tournament off of luck, and it just hasn't happened.
So, same here, Fred.
You don't need luck. You don't need luck. You're Fred Roumbanis. You got so much skill, you don't need luck. No, but think about it this way. Yeah. Which would luck help
when you
more
throw that Senko out there?
Tournament?
What's that?
Let's talk about it. A 4-day tournament eliminates luck more than a 1-day tournament.
Sure, absolutely.
An every fish count tournament eliminates some of the luck that you have with a 5-fish tournament.
Eliminating the amount of boats as well. Like if you have a 500 boat or a 1,000 boat tournament, that is a lucky.
Yes.
You've got to get lucky. I will say you got to
get lucky.
You got to, because you got to get lucky that no one else found the same fish you found. You got to get lucky that you even get bit with all that boat commotion and, you know, everybody running around on some of these lakes. I mean, when I see these McDonald's big bass splashes down at Lake Fork, I feel like the only way you're going to win that tournament is luck. So, yeah.
Yeah.
McDonald's is involved in that, Freddie?
What's that?
McDonald's gets involved in that?
It's called the McDonald's Big Bass Splash, right, Ken?
They've got a few.
It used to be called. I don't know if it still is, but you know, it's my
It used to be run by Bob Seeley and his organization or something.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
Yeah, I don't know who sponsors it these days, but that thing's a mess. But anyway, I was thinking that since this is another advancement in the sports technology, maybe it helps to eliminate luck in some degree. And I would be in favor of that. But I love what you talk about learning about the fish, because, you know, when I was a kid growing up, one of the things that you always read was you can have structure without bass, but you will never have bass without structure. Well, it turns out that ain't true.
Yeah,
that is not true. There are bass out there just swimming. And I don't think we appreciated that.
Mm. We forget that they don't have to. They're not like us. They don't have to be on the ground. They don't have to be in a house. They don't have to. They like to eat. That's what they like to do. If there's bait, they're going to go out there wherever the bait's at, and they're going to find it, and they're going to eat it, and they're going to chill because they can just kind of sit there because they're fish and they swim. And, you know, sometimes we overthink it so much to the point where, like, wait a minute, there's no reason for them not to be out there. I go out in the ocean, right. You know, back in the day, we'd go out salmon fishing out in the middle of, you know, just following the anchovies. You know, it's like, where the salmon go. There's no
structure. They can hold their breath for a really long time is what you're saying, Fred.
They can.
I love that line. They can hold their breath for a long time.
But yeah, I mean, that's all taught. You know, that LiveScope's taught us that, though. LiveScope has taught us that.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Really personal question. Do you enjoy the technology?
So I do. I really, really do. But I enjoy it. So last year I had two graphs, right? I had one rigged up on a pole that I could mechanically use off a little switch here, and then one on my trolling motor. So I could live scope two at the front. So when Jackson and I fish together, we could just do our own thing, right?
Ah.
I'm having the dilemma right now, just fishing with my kids where we can just have fun together. You know what I'm saying? So you got, I just got to figure out how to make it work because it's so fun. Yeah. But it's hard when only one person gets to do it. You know, does that make sense? I know there's a lot of the crappie boats got two of them and they got two going like this so they can just sit in chairs and run them separately. So yeah,
that whole crappie thing, like sitting in chairs and just looking around, like that sounds pretty freaking. The older I get, the more I realize that those guys really haven't figured out. Like, yeah. Do they have boats with a bimini top?
Sure, I would imagine.
A little bit of shade, a cooler right in the middle. Yeah. You know, like you and your buddy sit there,
build a crappie there.
A little bit of music.
Yeah.
BTC wants one of those hats.
I saw my BTC son run up to me on the water the other day, and I heard music coming, and I'm like, where is it? He had a little boom box in there.
Hell yeah.
I was like, man, I remember when I was young.
Hey, he's out there biting. Jamming.
No, he's like, Dad, you think it matters? And he's catching them. I guess apparently not.
That's awesome.
That's awesome. I think Brian wants to, in 5 years, he's going to be fishing out of one of those helmets that has the two beers and the straw on it. He's just going to try to automate everything.
The little bell on the end of the rod to wake you up when the fish bites. And then you grab it, you try to shake it off. And if it don't come off, you throw it in. It sounds like a good time.
Fred Roumbanis, you're awesome. Thank you so much for joining us.
No, you guys are awesome. Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate it.
We really appreciate it. And I hate that you're not in the Red Crest this year, but it does mean I'll get to visit with you on the floor of the expo. So I'm looking forward to that.
Yes.
Who's leading today? I'm sorry.
Michael Neal is leading, isn't he? Yeah.
And there's actually a college kid. I don't know if he's still in college or not, but he won the college championship and he is in second.
Oh, yeah, wow. He was leading for
from Monticello.
While. Yeah, who? His name is from Monticello, Alabama. Yep. His last name is Head. I met him yesterday. Impressive young man, very nice young man, and what an experience that was.
Youth movement. There's that youth movement you're talking about right there.
Some tells me he knows his way around Livescope.
This happens to be his. You know, I was watching live on the way here. I mean, I shouldn't say I was watching it while I was driving, but I was listening to it, and they mentioned that this is actually his home lake too. So, the chances of not only him winning that championship, but then getting to familiar waters—that is—that's something. So,
that's freaking awesome.
Yeah, but doesn't mean anything against these guys. I promise you, local advantage does not mean anything against these guys.
No.
How'd Kevin do today?
That can be a curse.
What's that?
How'd Kevin do today?
Kevin was not doing well. I can tell you he was down in the high 40s when I last saw his name on there. But I will tell you where Kevin is right now. Out of 50 anglers, he is 49th right now. Mm. So Kevin is struggling in what is his second to last professional event. He's got a heavy hitters coming up, but this obviously being the Red Crest is he'd love to go out on top in this one, but he's got a hole to climb out of at this point. Yeah. And that young man's name, the college kid, is Dalton Head. He is in second place. Oh, there you go.
Dad's real name.
And your real name
was yeah.
Fuck.
Or Roumbanis. Or Roumbanis.
Greek. It's Greek. Like it was, yeah.
But
we're by Kelly.
We really appreciate you, Fred. You're the best and absolutely one of my favorite guys in the sport. Always enjoy spending time with you and a real treat to have you on Bass After Dark.
Man, so much fun. Thank you guys. Y'all have a good evening. And I'll see you
all. Thanks, Freddie.
You too.
Brian, you gonna be there?
No, I'm in New Jersey, bud.
But you'll be at the Classic next week. I'll be there too.
That's the plan.
I'll see you guys. Later.
Thanks, Freddie.
I didn't see you do that. Man, I was having all kind of tech issues here.
Yeah, you did good.
I could I was hearing like one out of every three words that was said during much of it. Sometimes I had it pretty clear, but I apologize for screwing up the show. Because I was struggling.
It's usually me, so thank God it wasn't me that destroyed the show this time.
No, that was you. So if the show was a train wreck, I was the conductor.
All right, so where are we at with this, Ken? We've done two shows, parts one and two. Where are we at with it? Is this a youth movement or a revolution?
Is it a youth movement or a tech? I'm going to say, because I don't want to sound like a cop out here, but I do believe it is a bit of both. But I believe it's 75% tech revolution and only 25% youth movement. I think the new anglers, the young anglers are very, a very talented group, but they've taken over so quickly that I do think the majority of it is their aptitude with the tech stuff. And here's why I think a lot of that is true. It had to do with some of the stuff we talked about on the show tonight. You know, if you were trying to learn how to flip in the past, you read an article or watched a video with Denny Brower or Greg Hackney or Roland Martin or somebody like that, and you learn from them. You learn from the master. Okay, if you want to learn how to finesse fish, you watched Aaron Martins or Mike Iaconelli or somebody like that. This is the first time that the gurus of the sport were no better than the guys who were just picking up the new technology at about the same time. And so you have a situation where the young guys who had greater experience with technology, especially technology of that ilk, we're actually surpassing the giants of the game. And that's why I think it's mostly tech. I think that gap will close. And I think things will even out. I think the young anglers will always have something of an advantage because they have a greater aptitude with this technology. But I do think it is mostly a tech revolution. What do you think?
I disagree. I mean, clearly it's definitely both. I think the technology has been out for 6, 7, 8 years now. It's definitely made leaps and bounds in the last couple of years. But they all have the same technology. The difference is these kids have put the time in with it. I don't fault the veteran anglers for not putting the time in with it. Some of it is complacency, but some of it, and a big part of it, is also just where you're at in your life. Right. Certainly. But a lot of it is also where you're at in your life. You know, I know, again, I said this last week, I remember growing up with Mike. I remember when he was breaking in, I remember him telling me he was recognizing that the older anglers were obligated to their sponsors, to their families, to all this and that. They weren't putting the time in that he was able to put in. And now Mike is older. I know Mike personally very well. And I know that he is not willing to put the time in now that he did then, because it means time away from your family. Sometimes there's a negative to being away from your family, and there's a price to pay for that. And he's not willing to pay that. You know, family comes first. So, and I think that's the case with a lot of these guys. Yes, there's complacency. They've been able to for years. Once you've got established, you have the history on the bodies of water. You have the knowledge that, you know, that you carry. Yes, every year rookies come up, but they don't have that experience that the veterans had. They could lean on that, and the rookies had to outwork them, and things were somewhat even. That's shifted. Forward facing has shifted that, because now the rookies putting in that extra work now have this huge advantage in with the technology. I think it's heavier on this class of rookie anglers that they're special.
Well, I'm gonna back up a little bit to something you said about the rookies outworking them and stuff like that. And I think you're absolutely right. I think everything you said, I don't disagree with much in substance. But here's, you also use the time on the water reference and experienced and proven pro anglers who have a great track record and so forth, they do have a lot of burdens put on them. It's not uncommon for a guy to have a really strong rookie season and follow up with a tough sophomore year because he's got a lot more burdens on him. Every angler you ask, every great bass angler you ask will tell you there's no substitute for time on the water. I certainly agree with that. But I'll tell you what,
yep.
This new technology is a shortcut to time on the water.
Yeah,
it is a shortcut. You don't have to look for 100 hours to find 8 brush piles. You can look for 10 minutes and find them. It reminds me of the poker world. I love playing poker. A lot of the Bass Pros love play poker. Love playing with the Bass Pros. That's a good time. But in the poker world, they used to say that the experience was irreplaceable. The time spent at the table, the number of hands you had accumulated over the course of your poker playing career. Well, the great equalizer turned out to be the internet, because you can play a hand of poker in lightning speed on the internet versus playing it at a table in a brick and mortar casino. So you would suddenly have guys who are 20, 25 years old who had played as many hands of poker as guys twice that age who had played just as often as they could.
Yeah.
It's an amazing equalizer out there.
Yeah. But so you say forward facing allows you to jump the line or something like that, but it's their time in with it that's made them better with it. Just having
I agree.
Doesn't do it. There's a lot of nuance with it that I think myself, certainly you, and you know the rest of the elites, the older elites, aren't privy to yet as far as what the conditions do to those roaming, suspending, pelagic fish. These kids know that better. They know that aspect of it better. They know how to get those fish to bite a lot better. I think that's what we're seeing right now.
And again, I think you're exactly right about all that. 1,000 hours or whatever it gets you there. Whether it's 5,000 hours, 10,000 hours, 20,000 hours, you better put that time in or you're not going to catch up.
Yeah. Yep. Yes, indeed. Ken?
We got a couple of seconds left. I'm here.
Yes, we do. We have.
All right, I'm coming in and out. It's brutal. Hopefully right, hotel will get same day service on internet soon.
Same day service. So we have bad comments. We have our top 10, and then we're going to close it out with dark thoughts. But Nathan, dark thoughts. Jacob, if you're ready, let's dive right into bad comments.
For someone to say that JP only needs to apply to that's an easy one.
Every time.
Welcome, Jacob. How are you?
I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm doing well. Jakey over here. My internet connection is not what it should be. I missed your entire lead-in segment there, but I heard the at the end, so I knew you're on.
Jacob, that's how you know I'm getting close by.
That's right. Do you know who Max Headroom is?
No.
Okay. We'll look that up after in the Bass After Dark segment, and you'll understand. But right. Ken's doing his best Max Headroom impression tonight. Jacob, take it away.
All right. We got a lot, so only the best, and we're going to move fast, or at least somewhat fast. Paul Benson is not apologizing for calling BTC a Yankee.
No. Thank you, Paul.
Paul, it's worse than that. Jacob is also a Yankee.
He's still fighting the war. A losing war. Carry on.
Anthony, Ken Duke without the cushion chair and the library is like Hackney without a jig.
There you go. Interesting he mentions Greg Hackney, because guess who was supposed to be our third guest tonight?
It's like Hackney without LiveScope or without Wi-Fi.
There you go.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Stephen Barden, Ken, do I need to wake up some anglers and drag them to your room?
Yeah, Stephen was kind enough to say, I'm right here with Gary Klein. I'll drag him up to the room and get him on the show. And I said, nah, we were already into the show at that point. So I said, we're gonna do the best we can with a couple of terrific guests, and we'll save Gary for another time.
Mm-hmm. We have that show in mind. Next. Yeah.
MJ, Randy's phone fell off his dash and he couldn't make it.
Oh! I like that one.
Yeah.
Chris H, can't wait for the classic to pick up new fish attractant scent by Gwyneth Paltrow.
Okay.
That's a good one. That's a good one, Chris. If we had gifts, you would get prizes. You would get one.
And we may have prizes soon.
Maybe.
Mm-hmm. BTC going for the second copyright strike?
Ah, yeah. That was, yeah. Carry on.
Bottom line, forward-facing sonar is here to stay, and so is Ken's wardrobe.
You know it, Blake. Blake, I'm actually considering adding another smoking jacket to the wardrobe arsenal. Haven't quite decided on that one yet, but the next one might be cream colored. So I think that could be good.
Cream colored?
I know you want me to stick with the purple, but I might
go with a lighter one. No, but you are in Florida. Cream colored. Yeah, I could see some nice pastels, you know, for the spring.
There you go. We may have to have a meeting about this.
Indeed.
Ken sort of has an Uncle Fester thing going.
How dare you?
Basila, that's not nice. Although I Brian reached out to me right before Halloween last October and said, hey, will you come on Ike Live dressed as Uncle Fester? And because it's my wonderful friend, Brian Stockel, Brian the Carpenter, I said, sure. And my wife did the makeup around the eyes, and I got the Uncle Fester jacket and the whole nine yards, and I did the show just for Brian and Mike and Pete and Becky.
Yes, and it must be added that Terry Battisi was also asked to come in costume. What was his costume supposed to be, Ken? Ken, do you remember?
I do remember. He was supposed – who was he supposed to come dressed as? I don't recall that.
Yeah.
Because there was no point in remembering that, because I knew he wasn't going to do it. Yeah, probably Ginger or Marianne from Gilligan's Island. I can't remember.
Yeah, it was a whale of an effort, Terry. Thank you for nothing. Next.
Practice? I don't need no stinking practice. I think this is an Allen Iverson reference.
No.
Yeah, that's absolutely an Iverson reference. Well, it's a combination of Treasure of the Sierra Madre, with Humphrey Bogart, directed by John Huston, and Allen Iverson. Ed is throwing a little disdain at Allen, or throwing a bone to Allen Iverson, but also to Treasure of the Sierra Madre. Ed, I hope I'm right on that. Ed, one of the great, great anglers, especially coming out of the Bass Nation world. He won a championship one year. He was good buddies with Brian Kirchhoff back in the day. And a threat to win any derby he's in.
Yes. Ken, I want to say it's Allen Iverson and Das Plimpet. Fudge.
Well, das badges. Plimpet. Badges. We don't need those thinking badges. That's Treasure of the Sierra Madre.
Oh, it is? 1948
Humphrey Bogart. Yeah, 1948 Humphrey Bogart, directed by John Huston.
But that wasn't Humphrey Bogart's line.
No, it's the Mexican banditos who are coming up the mountain to rob him of gold.
Yeah.
Some Mexican cast member, some just bit.
Jesus, Ken, relax. Whatever. Get over Sorry, it. Buddy. All right.
Goodbye. Four facing sonar systems at the cost of one of Ken's jackets.
Well, actually, just the lapel here is more than any forward-facing sonar unit I'm aware of.
Ken, I thought it was Don Knotts. All right.
We'll maybe in some of satirical reference Don Knotts did on the Andy Griffith Show or something, or the Incredible Mr. Limpet, but no.
That's not Don. Incredible Mr. Limpet. And I'm sorry, I'm probably wrong. Jacob,
Eric, me out. Guys who complain about forward-facing sonar P sitting down.
It's an outstanding.
Let's not do that. That was the whole point of my monologue. Let's keep the discussion on the merits and not cast aspersions on another human being just because he has a different opinion than you on something that is multifaceted.
Right. And maybe he wants to sit down and read, scroll Instagram while he's taking a pic.
There you go.
BTC looks like I.
That's
cheers, great. Devin.
If only forward-facing sonar could find Chester a girlfriend. Yikes. Chester is my college nickname.
Yeah.
Is that what Chester? What? Never mind. Next one.
Oh, no. It's a BTC-hosted show now.
Thankfully, not for too long. God.
Thank you, Steven. Thank you. Appreciate the support, brother. See you tomorrow at the expo. I'll be on the lookout for you.
It's a terrifying moment, Ken.
Talking like Criff Crochet, I said, forward-facing sonar, it's a devil.
That's actually Foghorn Leghorn. I'll say there.
Well, also Bobby Boucher.
Indeed.
This is what I say to Jacob and BTC all the time. You, sir, a Yankee and a scoundrel, but I repeat myself. Indeed.
Jacob, one more.
Ken forgot to tip the bellhop, so they're messing with his internet connection.
How dare you?
Yeah, you know, I got one show. I sent Nathan my numbers from the internet speed test I did, and it was just a tiny fraction of what I usually get at home, and he said, we may have some issues. Yeah, David X, you're right, man. I don't know. I gotta do better. I gotta get better here. But there was no better answer in this hotel. Sorry about that. I felt lucky that I was able to be on the show at all.
All right, last one, and then you can snap me off, Fred. It's a Bluetooth speaker, not a boombox, though. I'm sure that's what the Roumbanises call anything that makes sound.
That's very good, David. I like that. The boombox reference. Very
good. Who's David? Racer?
David Chong.
All right.
I don't even know what that was.
Ken, it's the same color as your jacket. Just same team. Purple. All right. Jacob, thank you. It was an outstanding rendition of bad comments from tonight's show. Appreciate you. Everybody, please go follow. What's your Instagram?
JMM_4.
Yep. Hit him up in the DMs. He likes lots of questions, TikTok links. Just bombard him with TikTok links and also full body mirror selfie shots. Jacob, thank you. Talk to you soon, buddy. Ken doing his best Walt Disney impression tonight in cryogenic chamber.
That's me.
Yes. No, thank you, Ken. Yeah.
I feel like I was holding you back tonight.
No, it's not your fault. The internet hasn't reached Alabama.
When it does, though.
They got great bass fishing. Everything else, not so much.
Pretty good football, college level. But yeah, internet, not so much. Not so much. A lot of good barbecue.
Have they fixed the city yet?
That is a subject of some debate, sir.
So when was the classic there? 3 years ago? Nah, 2020.
2020 was the last time. Yeah, Hank Cherry won. And, of course, right after the classic, I mean right after, COVID is in full boom. And the world changes.
Yeah, they got that one in. That
unbelievable.
Like, walking around Birmingham, I remember, being there for that. I was surprised, man. It felt like we were in Gotham City walking around Birmingham. I told you that the other night. Like, it's just no streetlights lit, you know, buildings with black plastic, you know, coming out of the windows. Just this place looked like it got carpet bombed. So,
yeah, you know, half my family is from Birmingham. My mom was born in Birmingham, and I still have some family here. I still have a cousin and a 90-year-old uncle here, and I visited them yesterday, and that was a treat to see them. I've spent a lot of time in my life in Birmingham because of having family here. And
now I feel like an a-hole, Ken.
No, don't. I used to, I tend to torment my family with jokes about Alabama. I will regale you with a few if you, no, I won't do that. But Alabama, I like to make jokes about Alabama.
Yes. Well, Ken.
Another time.
We're not getting the jokes. Maybe next week. Ken, thank you, buddy. I'll see you in the after world.
Thank you. Snap me off, man.
That's a wrap. Well, it is time for the top 10.
The top 10 signs you're not going to win a tournament. Number 10, you already won practice. Number 9, your title sponsor is PETA. Number 8, you think FFS is the acronym for a gender option. Number 7, you left your fairy wands at home.
Okay.
Number 6, you're confident your luck will change with new backward-facing sonar found on Craigslist. Number 5, you find the question catching any to be triggering. Number 4, on tournament days you put ice and salt in your live well, also tequila and lime juice. Number 3, you wonder why weigh-in bags are so big.
My God, it's huge!
Number 2, you think a transducer is a man dressed in women's clothes. And the number 1 sign you're not going to win a tournament? You're too old for forward-facing sonar, but too young to retire.
Outstanding. I think that was an outstanding top 10. Let us know what you guys think. Thanks again. Thank you to Ken Duke. This whole thing was his brainchild. Ken's awesome. I don't care what anybody says. Ken's the best. Thank you to Nathan, our engineer and the voice of the top 10, making this all possible. Thank you to Jacob, the Lizard King, Morrison, our intern. Again, guys, hit him up, J.M. Morrison or whatever it is, but just find him and spam him with nonsense. Thank you to James Riley, the creator of the amazing logo, and to Ron Sterling for our intro. Big thank you to you guys watching the show tonight. Really appreciate everybody that tunes in and comments. We try hard. Tonight was a tough one, man. You guys have no idea. It was tough. And a lot of guys were in and then they're out. And I mean, guys were in last night and out, find a replacement. And then today. So it was a tough one, man. And I get it. And honestly, it's not just their sponsors telling them what to do. It's the public opinion. You guys can be brutal out there with your comments. Just, you know, think about it sometimes what you say. People are watching and you know, they got feelings too, man. But yeah, thank you for your support. Appreciate it. Really, you guys are everything. And if you enjoy the show, give us a like, subscribe, tell a friend. Please subscribe to the YouTube channel. Follow us on Instagram and Facebook. I don't know, send Ken an email. And now, next show. So next week, we're going to be at the Classic and we're going to put something up. That's the plan. It may not be alive, but we'll see. We've got an idea on what we're going to do. We're going to bring you guys something. So stay tuned. Next week, same place, same time. And oh yes, this is a great tagline that Ken had come up with. Bass After Dark has the guest you want to hear from, even if you've never heard from them. I thought that's amazing. And it's kind of true, man. It's actually really true. And now it's time. I apologize. Last week, steamrolled right over my intro, my amazing intro that Nathan came up with. But now it's time for Dark Thoughts.
Did you go outside last night? Nah, one night. Nah, it's extremely bizarre. Nah. Definitely shock and disbelief.
And now Dark Thoughts by Brian the Carpenter.
This guy's naked.
Thank you, Nathan, for that. I saw this today on Instagram. Josh Douglas made a post. And again, everybody's weighing in on forward facing, and Josh kind of laid it out there. And there was a particular line in there that caught my attention. I'm going to read it to you right now. A sure sign of aging is fighting the process, which means you are no longer learning. If you let your guard down, there's always someone right behind you ready to take what they want because they want it just as bad. Thank you, guys. See you next week.